Hi, this is Rumki Goswami, and today is the 10th week of my Sunday series. It's been such an interesting chit-chat that I've had with all of you, and hope I've been able to spread some joy, give some information, and spread some positivity through music. So today, as I wrap up my Sunday series, I thought, why not kind of close it with some of the interesting questions like in my mailbox. I could have done it one-on-one, but then I thought maybe quite a few of us might have similar questions, so why not try and give it here. So the first question that I would like to take up is the difference between Western classical and Indian classical. A very interesting question. It comes to me very often, even when I'm giving stage performances or maybe I'm called as a guest speaker. This question comes to me very often. So. To just give a glimpse of what are the differences, let me start with the major three differentiators, which is one is about melody versus harmony. So Indian classical is all about melody. We move from one note to the other in a sequential format. So one singer or the lead vocalist is there on stage and other artists are all accompanying artists. So the singer over here moves from note to note and probably improvises a few things in the process, and when the entire piece comes out, it comes out as a piece, it comes out as a melodious piece. It's called a piece on melody. So the ruling factor here is melody, whereas in Western it is about harmony. So they give layers of melody together to create harmony. Well, we move from sa to re, re to ga. They might have samapa, somebody playing samapa, somebody doing regama, somebody doing dhanisa together, you know, in their pitches. And the intention is when they come together, it should create a harmony. So that is the leading point in Western classical. And also there is no concept like a lead singer or a lead choir or nothing like that. So everybody is a leader in their own way. They are doing their own pieces, and therefore it is already staged, already rehearsed, already composed. So there is no scope of improvisation, because one improvisation could lead to a huge mistake and the entire harmony could go for a toss. So this is the first differentiating element. The second differentiating element is the scale and the pitch. So Indian classical singers are trained to sing in all the octaves, lower, middle and higher. So if required, I can go to the kharaj notes of ni, dha, pa, ma, ga, re, down. And then I can also go up to pa, dha, and to the highest note possible wherever there is required, that is. So whereas in Western, it's all as per the convenience of the singer and the voice that the singer is blessed with. So if a voice cannot go to the higher pitch, maybe that the person will just stick to the middle octave. So it is only as per the convenience of the singer or the performer that they are trained in a particular way. Soprano is the highest scale over there. And so they kind of do their training accordingly. So pitching and the scale that we use is the range that Indian classical versus Western classical, that is very different. Okay, now the third is, of course, the beat cycle. We follow a cyclic pattern, that is, if there is a start, there is also an end. So we have beat cycles like 16 beats, 12 beats, 8 beats. So we start counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and the moment it is either 12 or 16, we know that cycle ends. We need to stop that line there and the fresh line needs to start. So we are always driven by that sum, which is denoted by a cross sign. So singers over here would be able to understand what I'm trying to say. There's a cross sign which denotes sum. So the moment the sum is hitting, we know that, okay, that the cycle is ending over there and we need to start the fresh cycle. Whereas in Western, it's linear. So it is 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, without any end, it just goes on and on and on. So imagine train running on tracks. It's just going, 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 moving, moving, moving. So that is what. So they do not have that anxiety of coming and hitting that sum and to start a fresh cycle. So if they are on the linear beat, they can start anywhere, start anytime, stop anywhere, you know, that kind of a thing. Not that in Indian Bollywood, linear beats are not followed. There are quite a few songs which have linear beats, like aage bhi jaane na tu पीछे भी जाने न तू. So this is linear beats. It's going 1 2 1 2 1 2. There is no cycle. So this is again the third differentiator. And of course there are other differentiators like the voice modulation techniques. We use mudki, khatka, need. They use falsetto notes. They use vibratos. So when we are hitting, when we are singing with a clear voice, we are hitting a particular note. Sa, it goes. And if whereas a Western singer would give a vibrato to that at the end, they will just so there is a wave. So you can if you observe or listen intentively all those Christmas carols and other Western songs, you will easily see the vibrato that they give. So these are certain techniques, voice modulation techniques, which are very, very different from Indian classical. This was a glimpse, but I hope it just gave you a little bit of an overview about what is Indian vis-a-vis what is Western. Now, what is the second question? Okay, the second question is about the difference between Thumri and Chaiti. Now, this is a wrong question. There is no difference between a Thumri and a Chaiti. Chaiti belongs to the family of Thumris. So, if Thumri is the parent, Chaiti, Hori, Kajri, they are all part of the Thumri family. Chaiti represents the Thumris, which are sung in the month of Chait, which have a feeling of separation, wanting to unite. It is that calendar month, that month of Chait, which is I think the first month in the Hindu calendar. Then there is Hori, which is sung in the Holi festival. Then there is Kajri for monsoon. So these are all various types of Thumris. So do not nurse this idea that Chaiti and Thumri are two different genres. It is one genre, it is one family. And you've also requested for a Chaiti. Of course, sure, I'll sing two lines from a legendary Chaiti. And in this Chaiti, this girl is telling her dad that I really want to go to my husband's place now. Please take me to him. So she wants to unite that belongingness or that longing to meet, and because of the separation that has happened or whatever. And Chaiti is sung during the Ram Navami time and all, because that's the Chait Mahina. So one legendary Chaiti that is Chadhi le Chait Chit lage Ho Rama Baba ke Bhavan ma Chadhi le चैत चित लागे हो रामा बाबा के भवनवा चढ़ी ले चैत चित लागे वीर भवनवा सगुण बिचारो वीर दिन कब हुई है प्यार से मिलनवा हो रामा कब हुई है प्यार से मिलनवा हो रामा बाबा के भवनवा चढ़ी ले चैत चित लागे. So that was a Chaiti. Now the third question that I have is super interesting. This is about somebody wanting to know the ragas that can be sung in the summer heat, which can give a cooling effect. Okay, I have a lot of raga related questions with me, which I will deal with in my next series because those are heavy questions. But this one I can definitely help you with now. So, there are some ragas which can give you that ruafza feeling, which can quench your thirst and save you from picking up that bottle of cola The ragas which I recommend listening to in summer season is, one is Rag Malwa. So if you are a classicalist, you know what Rag Malwa is all about. Please either sing it or listen to it. And if you are a Bollywood buff, so the songs, there are quite a few songs in Rag Malwa, and there is one that stands out, which is from the movie Sathiya. The song is Chupke se na 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 raat ki chadar tale chand ko bhi aahat na ho la 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 la. Sorry, I don't remember the lyrics, but this is a beautiful song. Please listen to it. It actually gives you that instant wow, cooling, nice, fresh feel. Listen to it. Then there are other songs which are from the Sarang family. It could be Gaur Sarang, Vrindavani Sarang, Manmad Sarang, whatever it is. Listen to the songs composed from the Sarang family. Those are also very, very breezy in nature. They give you that nice, airy, comfortable, cooling feel. One such song which is from the movie Padmavat, Ghumar, based on Vrindavani Sarang and Manmad Sarang, I think the stanzas goes to that. Listen to that. That is very nice and gives you a nice feel. Then there are songs like Kashmir Ki Kali. Hai re hai tere bal pe tera na la 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 balle balle hai 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 hai. So that is again Vrindavani Sarang. Please listen to it. Then there is Jhooti Mooti Batiya Van Bole from the movie Rudali. So these are all from the Sarang family. They can give you that instant cooling, nice, happy, breezy feel. Look for songs, type Sarang family songs or Rag Malwa songs in Google and you will get plenty. Listen to them. Then there is Haveli Sangeet, which you can listen to, but which is Haveli Sangeet is primarily based on Dhrupad and Damar, and it is based on an individual choice. So I leave it to you. Look for Haveli Sangeet and you'll get multiple options. You'll get many kirtans and Krishna bhajans and all based on Haveli Sangeet. So it all depends on your individual choice. So that was my answer to this question. Now I'll take one last question. This is a serious and a very important question. And this is for some raga therapy for asthma patients. Okay, so I've got a lot of success stories around raga therapy for asthma and severe bronchitis. So there are certain therapies, raga therapies that is, which can help you a lot with these asthma attacks. They can lessen the number of attacks. They can kind of heal you. How does it happen? So first and foremost, listen to wind instruments like flute, shehnai, mouth organ. So listen to solo compositions, listen to any solo flute rendition, listen to any shehnai piece, listen to any mouth organ. They are extremely beneficial for the lungs. Do that. And in terms of ragas, you might want to try Darbari Kanara, Mia Mallar, Bhairavi and Rag Durga for immunity. So when somebody comes to me for raga therapy, for anything to do with lungs, especially asthma and bronchitis, I give a mix of these ragas for the therapy, and it is all given during stipulated hours in the day. And it's not that if I've written 5 to 7 a.m. in the morning, listen to this, it doesn't mean that you actually have to listen from 5 to 7. You can also just listen to 30 minutes anytime between 5 and 7 a.m. in the morning or during bedtime. So for the lack of a better terminology, I'm using the word prescription. So I kind of curate a customized prescription for every individual, because every case is slightly different. But there are a lot of success stories which kind of talk about the healing aspect that has happened with raga therapy. So for the time being, till you come to me personally for this, listen to wind instruments, listen to these ragas, the ragas that I told you, Mia Malla, Darbari Kanara, Bhairavi, Rag Durga. So dabble in these, listen to it. If you can sing, great. If you can't, just plug in, just go to the YouTube channels, look for these ragas, listen to it. So these really, really help, and it's proven that raga therapy can be a big healer for asthma and bronchitis patients. So this is a little that I could share for now. I will be ending my Sunday series with this. As I told you, it's been a great learning experience for me also in the, you know, in the process. Probably I have learned a lot as well, and I'm working on some other concepts which I will be coming up with very shortly. And soon, once the COVID thing is better and travel bans are lifted, I will start traveling for my performances. This summer, that is this May, I had an international performance lined up which couldn't happen, but then it'll happen when it has to. So I'm just waiting for the right time, and I will see you soon again. Do keep writing to me. I'm very much available on my email ID. I'm accessible on all social media channels. I have my website, which is yet to get updated. It's still in a very shabby stage. I have not worked on it since long, but nonetheless, whatever little information you want, need about me, you can get it there. I'm on Wikipedia. And there are ample ways in which you can reach out to me. Stay in touch, and I'm very, very accessible and available on social media. Thank you so much, and see you soon.